The definition of God is not static. It means different to different people. So far, the definition of God that I have come to have discovered is truth. And the definition of Guru for me is someone who can make me realize the beauty of truth. Now, provided there come an instance in my life where I have realized that the truth exists and I can see the truth. But also I am worried by my ongoing life and the activities in my life which are at hand and by the planning that I've already done or I've been doing for ages or for years. So with what intensity should I pursue my truth and should I be giving up on the ongoing life or the activities in my life? And what energy should I be spending in the exploration of the truth further without worrying about the future?
Your question hinges on the statements of your assumptions. You have made three very prominent assumptions. First, truth has a definition and the definition is variable. Second, truth exists and I can see with it with my own eyes. First of all, that which can be defined is only a shoddy semblance of truth. Truth can neither be perceived nor defined at all. Forget about a static definition, even a variable definition is not possible. To have the intention to define truth is to become a victim of the ego. The ego says, everything is within my purview. Everything is delineable, definable. I can define what this brick is, I can define what this wire is, I can define what this hillside is, I can define what the various processes around me are. I can define a cat against a dog. So I can define the truth as well. Don't you see how blatantly you are objectifying the truth? Only objects present themselves to definitions. This is a matter of fundamentals. The one who begins right at the beginning must know that I am not going to some place that is knowable, traceable, or definable. And if I am going to any such place, then I am only going to a place within my own mind. If that is my intention, then it is the usual run-of-the-mill circulatory movement of the mind within itself. I'm really not going anywhere. I'm just expending myself within myself. The second thing you said was truth exists. Truth is the only one that does not exist. This table exists. This grass exists. They exist because they exist as per your perception. They exist in time and space. They exist because your senses can perceive them. Does truth exist for you if this table exists? How can the truth exist? If you call this table as existent in the same breath, in the same vein, how can you call the truth too as existent? The table has limits. Truth has no limits. The table can be seen. The truth cannot be seen. The table is here. The truth is either nowhere or everywhere. This is an object. It exists. The truth is not an object. How can it exist? But we like to say truth exists. Why do we like to say that? Because just as I can be on top of everything that exists, the moment I make the preposterous claim that truth exists, I can be on top of the truth as well. Do you see the dirty work of the ego at play here in saying that truth exists? And not only am I saying that truth exists, I'm also claiming that I can see it. Remember that whatever you can see or think of or even imagine is something that you can control. In saying that you can see the truth, all that you are saying is, well, you know, I run the universe. I am the queen of my world. I'll do it my way. Neither does truth exist, nor can it be seen. Truth sees everything. Truth is the witness that sees. You cannot see the truth. A witness that can be seen is a very poor witness. Witness, by definition, is the one who remains hidden, who just watches and is never there in the public glare. You cannot see the witness, or can you? And if you are seeing the witness, then the witness has already become a participant. If you are seeing the truth, then the truth has already become an object. The truth has already become another figment of your imagination. Do I need to take up the question that you are asking? A question that rests on shaky assumptions is a question that must be shaken off. When you ask questions, first of all, ask, what is the assumption behind my question? As long as there are assumptions, there will be questions. And as long as there are assumptions, all questions will be worthless. Which, by the way, implies that no question really means anything, because all questions rest on assumptions. Hence, what you must explore is the assumptions on which you are living your life. Before you ask, what must I do further? Questions of intensity and movement and future. Before you ask them, you must first ask, what am I doing right now? Living on assumptions? Living a fairy tale? Wake up. Wake up from your dream stuff. First of all, see what is really happening. Go into the facts of your life. See how you relate to people, see how you talk, how you walk, see how the day is spent. Look at the quality of your decisions and the center they come from. Before you start wondering about the future, why not look externally and honestly at this moment? Is that not commonsensical? Yes? I do not know where I am standing, but I am quite interested in knowing where I must go. If you do not know where you are standing, how do you know where you must go? And our situation is even more absurd. Not only we do not know where we are standing, we do not even know who is standing. I do not know where I am standing. I do not know who I am. But my question is about my destination. Now, how relevant is this question? Do we take it up seriously? Do we? Or do I first return to myself? Do I first start looking honestly at myself? Do I first tackle things that are current? What am I doing today since morning? How am I eating? How am I relating? How am I sleeping? How am I dressing? How am I talking? From where does my choice of words emerge? From where do my phrases emanate? Who is speaking behind my voice? Can I see that I am so deeply influenced? Where am I in all this? That's the thing that must sincerely concern you. The future then will automatically take care of itself. You don't have to worry about the future. You don't have to decide the intensity with which you must plunge yourself in the spiritual flow. Spirituality itself will decide on your behalf. You will not be burdened with taking any decisions. In moving towards God, the easy part is He decides the movement. But only if you are really honest in moving towards Him. As long as you are wondering what to do to move towards God, who is still in charge? Who is still in charge? If you are still in charge, why do you claim that you are moving towards God? He will decide. You take care of yourself. He will take care of the rest. You be honest in looking at yourself. Everything else He will take care of. You be forthright with the facts. The truth will never be distant. It is amusing. Actually, had it not been tragic, I would have said it is amusing. How we entertain ourselves with mental toys. You know, that happens. When you don't have the real thing, you have to make do with toys. When you don't have the truth, then you regale yourself with assumptions about the truth, images of the truth. Who taught us all these things? That the truth has a variable definition. Who is going to define truth? Are we talking of truth defined by man? Then are we talking of truth that varies with persons? We are saying the definition of truth is variable. If it is variable, then it is surely varying according to my own convenience. If it suits me, then I take this definition. Doesn't suit me, I change the definition. Oh, variable. Nice. Now the truth is my orderly. Now the truth obeys my commands. Now the truth is subservient to my leisures. Kindly spare the truth. Just bow down to it. Don't think about it. Just bow your head down. Don't try to bring the unfathomable into the limited purview of your small brain. Just surrender. Keep a few things out of your touch. One never touches the truth. One dissolves in the truth. You have heard about the salt lump. It wanted to touch the truth. The only way it could find was dissolution. That is the only way you will know the truth. By not being, by not remaining, by surrendering, by dissolving, by losing your form, shape, personality, assumptions, opinions, everything. As long as you are insistent about who you are in this shape, in this body, with your opinions, with your assertions, with your assumptions, truth will remain distant. That will remain distant to you, which is actually the most intimate. And that is so funnily tragic. That which sits in your heart will remain distant to you. Yes? Go to the scriptures, please. The scriptures very succinctly, often in one word, just say it all. And take those words to your heart, literally to your heart. Aparibhashet. What does that mean? Cannot be defined. And Sanskrit is the language of scriptures. Hindi happens to be quite close. Hindi mein bolna seekhiye. Nahi to aparibhashe aapke liye koi arth nahi rakhega.
Meaning ke liye.
Koi wajah hai ki main Hindi mein bolta hoon. Hindi Sanskrit ke bahut kareeb hai. Bahut sare shabd usne Sanskrit se liye hain. Sanskrit nishth hai Hindi. आप भी वहीं से आती हैं, जरा मिट्टी से जुड़ी है, मिट्टी इतनी भी बुरी नहीं है, हिंदी में बोलिए, हिंदी में बोलेंगे तो संस्कृत के करीब आएंगे, संस्कृत के करीब आएंगे तो शास्त्रों के करीब आएंगे, शास्त्रों के करीब आएंगे तो सत्य के करीब आएंगे।
क्या भाषा इतनी इम्पोर्टेंट?
बहुत है, बहुत है।
भाषा ना आती हो
तो उसे सीखनी पड़ती है। बहुत सारे लोग हैं, ऋषिकेश चले जाइए, वहाँ पर हिंदी स्पीकिंग कोर्स, संस्कृत स्पीकिंग कोर्स चलते हैं। उन लोगों के लिए तो दिक्कत होती ही है जो भाषा से परिचित ना हो। अंग्रेजों के साथ बहुत सत्र करे हैं मैंने, उन बेचारों तक मैं कबीर को कैसे लेके आऊं? कबीर के अनुवाद में कबीर बचते ही नहीं। आप भाग्यवान हैं कि आप उत्तर भारत में पैदा हुई हैं। अपने भाग्य को दुर्भाग्य मत बनाइए। बेचारे अंग्रेज रोते हैं कि उनको हिंदी नहीं आती, हमें हिंदी आते हुए भी हम जैसे वैश्विक व्यापार की भाषा अंग्रेजी है, भूलिएगा नहीं कि अध्यात्म की भाषा संस्कृत है, और है तो है। हर भाषा के पीछे एक माहौल होता है, उसके जन्म की एक कहानी होती है। संस्कृत व्यापार के लिए नहीं रची गई थी, संस्कृत है ही इसीलिए कलात्मक अभिव्यक्ति के लिए, आध्यात्मिक अभिव्यक्ति के लिए। अंग्रेजी में अध्यात्म जरा टेढ़ा पड़ेगा, पड़ेगा तो पड़ेगा। ये बात आपसे ज्यादा अंग्रेज समझते हैं बेचारे। यूरोप गए थे, वहाँ उनको कबीर की एक पंक्ति बताएं, फिर उसका अंग्रेजी में अनुवाद करें, फिर कहें कि अब गाओ। और बेचारे तरसते थे कि काश हमें कबीर समझ में आ पाते। आपका सौभाग्य है कि आपको आ सकते हैं। अपने लिए ये व्रत बनाइए कि कम से कम अभी जब तक शिविर है तब तक अंग्रेजी का एक शब्द उच्चारित नहीं करेंगी, हिंदी में बात करिए। वैसे भी ढर्रा टूटे तो ये शुभ लक्षण ही होता है ना। कोई भी ढर्रा अगर टूटता है तो ये अच्छी ही बात होती है ना।